four squares later today on most of these RBS stations. RBS. Next, Betrayal and Remembrance in the continuing saga of love and life in Morningside. Move on up to RBS.
We interrupt our regular programming to bring you this special bulletin from RBS News.
Good morning. This is Susan Miles in New York. There's a rapidly unfolding situation in Charleston, South Carolina, this morning, where an unidentified group is holding four hostages on board a ship. Apparently, they are demanding to make a statement live over the RBS network. Megan Barkley is in Charleston and has more on that story.
Susan, the situation began approximately 1 hour ago when the Coast Guard attempted to board a vessel that had berthed at the wrong dock. The footage you are about to see was taken by a crew from the RBS affiliate in Charleston, WPIV. This is unedited material. As you'll see, events were happening very rapidly.
Charleston docks were quiet today as talks broke down again between longshoremen and the Port Authority.
This is quiet, right?
Great.
Very nice. Thank you.
All right. Dock strike, take four. Charleston docks were quiet today.
What's going on here? What's happening here? You trying to get closer, Captain, all right? Come on, let's get closer. Get that guy up there. Get that guy up there. Get the guy in the boat. You got him? Want to get a little closer? You okay? Come on. That guy's got an Uzi, man. I think he's got an Uzi. Come on.
Reporter Stephen Levitt and cameraman George Takashima were covering a dock worker strike. Instead, they found themselves in the midst of a gunfight.
What the hell is going on here?
That was the last image from Stephen Levitt's camera an hour ago. However, in a bizarre turn to an already bizarre situation, Stephen Levitt was not the only person recording that gunfight. Tourist Leonard Mattelman of Wheeling, West Virginia, was on a sightseeing boat taking pictures of the aircraft carrier Yorktown across the harbor. He heard the shots behind him and focused his Super 8 on what was happening. Mr. Mattelman caught on film what Stephen Levitt couldn't, the appearance of two more gunmen on the dock who took Levitt, his cameraman, and the two remaining Coast Guardsmen hostage. Mr. Mattelman was flabbergasted at what he saw.
When I first saw what looked like a kidnapping, I took the pictures with my camera. And then I just realized that there was all the shooting going on, so I just ducked down. Yes.
Within minutes, police had closed off the area, and the three wounded Coast Guard personnel were taken to area hospitals. The ship, a tugboat named Liberty May, was found to have been leased out of Norfolk, Virginia, 3 days ago by someone named James Lawson. For 30 tense minutes, that's all that was known. Then WPIV, the RBS affiliate in Charleston, received a radio telephone call from Stephen Levitt.
I'm allowed to say that I'm being held on the ship. I am unhurt. George is here along with the two Coast Guard personnel. They have a demand. What they want is a live feed over RBS.
Tell them.
All right, I'm being told to say that if they don't, that they will begin to kill the hostages in 1 hour if they do not receive a live network feed.
Okay, that's it.
Susan, that's where the situation stands right now. As I said, the call took place 30 minutes ago. Since then, there's been no further contact. I understand there have been discussions with RBS in New York. You'd know more about that than I.
Thank you, Meg. We do know more about that now. As you can see, I've been joined by the dean of RBS News, John Woodley. John, I understand you were a participant in those discussions.
Yes, thank you, Susan. I've just come from 25 minutes of meetings between the FBI and representatives of RBS News. Just moments ago, an agent from the FBI's New York Bureau had this to say. Do we have that yet? This is right after the meetings.
Now, the Bureau can't take a position on what they broadcast. We're not censors. Our policy is to save lives wherever possible.
This is not the time to go into the ethical questions, and many are raised here involved in giving unrestricted access to the airwaves. The point right now is that lives are being threatened. Now, this group, whoever they are, has proved its seriousness by wounding three Coast Guard personnel. The FBI and RBS management feel that, literally, when someone is holding a gun to your head, you do as you're told.
And with that disclaimer, we're going back to Meg Barkley with the understanding that the preparations for that live feed are underway. Meg, do you see any sign of that?
Susan, a WPIV crew began stringing cable in the direction of the ship a few moments ago, but they seem to have been stopped by several of the police ringing the dock.
Meg, it's our understanding that the FBI has spoken with the local police.
There they go, John. They're stringing the cable toward the ship.
Meg, do you have any information on Steve Levitt?
I've met Steve Levitt on several occasions, actually. He's very well thought of. I understand he's 31, he's single, he's a graduate of the University of North Carolina, and he's been a reporter at WPIV for 3 years. I don't know if you can see it, but there's somebody there.
There is one. He's coming. I believe this is one of the terrorists. He's still holding an automatic weapon. He's taking the cable. He's taking it onto the ship. He has the cable. I think it'll be a few moments now before the connection is made.
John, I have some information about the cameraman, George Takashima. He's 39 years old, is married with 4 children, has won several awards for outstanding camera work, and was a combat photographer during the Vietnam War. Susan, we have some information about one of the Coast Guardsmen. He is at an area hospital. He is in critical condition. So far, he's been undergoing...
Excuse me, Meg. We seem to be making contact with the ship.
Out on the dock.
I believe that was Stephen Levitt, Stephen the reporter, Levitt. Being held hostage on board the ship in Charleston, South Carolina.
Dock in harbor.
Sometimes these connections are very difficult to make.
My cameraman.
Mr. Levitt, this is John Woodley in New York. Can you hear me?
John Woodley. John, yes, yes, I can hear you. Yes, this is Stephen Levitt in Charleston. Let me start over, if you may. This morning, while covering a dock strike, my cameraman, George Takashima, and myself witnessed an extraordinary firefight that broke out between
Coast
Guardmen
and the crew aboard
this
ship. Yes, we were able to see that amazing footage.
During the course
Levitt,
of that firefight, we were taken hostage and are now being held along with 2 Coast Guardsmen, whom I believe you can see them
Steve,
behind me.
Susan Miles here.
Yes.
Are there any injuries aboard the ship?
No, Susan, no. There are no injuries aboard the ship. Everybody here is fine.
Can you tell us who this group is and what their demands are?
I can tell you that the leader of the group is Dr. Bruce Lyman. With him are Dr. David McKeeson, I believe.
That's good. Okay, all right, Mr. Lyman. Mr. Woodley, if you don't mind, I'm Bruce Lyman. This is Dr. Dave McKeeson. And with us are Diane Silverman, Jim Seaver, and Frieda Barton.
Dr. Lyman, you have demanded a live feed over the RBS network as a condition for the release of the hostages.
Yes, Mr. Woodley, we're going to begin to release the hostages, the Coast Guardsmen, in a few moments, as soon as we have an understanding.
The Coast Guard hostages. Now, what about Mr. Levitt and Mr. Takashima?
I'm sorry, we're going to need Mr. Levitt and Mr. Takashima for further communications.
Sir, the agreement called for the release of all the hostages.
No, Mr. Levitt. No,
John Woodley, Dave McKeeson here. The agreement, I believe, called for the release of the hostages, and so we will now. We might do it now.
That's
we will
right.
now be releasing the Coast Guard hostages. Okay,
Mr. Levitt and Mr.
That's outrageous.
No, Mr. Woodley, I can guarantee you that Mr. Levitt. No harm will come to Mr. Levitt or to Mr. Takashima as long as our feed is not interrupted.
And what are our options?
No, you don't have any, John.
We're not discussing that now.
Are they around the front?
Yeah.
Mr. Woodley, I believe that that Meg Barkley on the dock can verify that the Coast Guardsmen are being released right now. Mr. Woodley, do you have that?
Meg, are you hearing this?
Susan, I don't see anyone right now. Oh, wait a minute. There are some people.
I think there are It looks, there are two Coast Guard personnel coming around the front of the tugboat now, and a van has driven up. It's an emergency response van, a Coast Guard, there's one of the terrorists, I think that was the same terrorist we saw earlier. They're being greeted, the two Coast Guardsmen are being released. They are being placed into the van now. The crowd here is cheering. And the van is driving away.
Dr. Lyman, I understand you have a statement to make.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Woodley. Ms. Miles. We're a group. We're a group that believes in survival. And I am a former strategic weapons planner for the Pentagon, so I know whereof I speak. There has been a serious change in the strategic thinking of our leaders. They now believe that they can wage nuclear war. They believe that they will wage nuclear war, and they believe that they'll win it. Now, if that frightens you, that's good. We're here in Charleston today because Charleston is a major staging area for nuclear offense. You have Poseidon submarines, you have Air Force and naval weapons areas, and we think that this is a good place to start. What's happening? Okay, good. Keep an eye on. So Charleston is the place for us to start. We have a demand. We want the detonating modules from every single nuclear warhead in the Charleston area, and there are 968 of them. We want them delivered to this dock by 4:30 tomorrow afternoon so that we can take them out to sea and destroy them. This is known as unilateral disarmament. It's the first step on a long road. With Charleston disarmed, the Soviet Union can take steps to do likewise with their westernmost installations. And we believe that this action, as radical as it is, can set in motion the most dramatic movement for peace in the last 30 years. All right? Good. But if our demands are not met, it means that our government is willing to throw away the lives of the people of Charleston. It means that our leaders have not yet awakened to the grave dangers that are facing all of us. Listen to me closely once again. My colleagues and I have constructed our own nuclear device and placed it on board this ship. If the detonators are not delivered by 4:30 tomorrow afternoon, or if our exit from the harbor is blocked in any way, the device on board the ship will explode at 6 p.m. tomorrow. And believe me, it will illustrate what it is we all have to fear. I think we do this not in anger, but as a desperate plea and in hope of lasting peace. And I believe that that's all that there is to say at this time. Thank you. Mr. Levitt, there's nothing more to say at this time, and I want you to cut back to New York, and the authorities are going to have to think about what Charleston is worth to them.
What you've just heard is a statement by a group of, well, terrorists, I guess you'd have to call them, John, who are holding four hostages aboard a ship in the harbor in Charleston, South Carolina.
Well, Susan, nuclear terrorism is something that this country has feared for a long time. Let's make this clear. We don't know anything about this group. We have no evidence that their threat is real. There have been several hoaxes of this kind in recent years.
Well, nevertheless, they claim to have a nuclear bomb on board, and they're threatening to explode it by 6 o'clock tomorrow evening if their demands are not met. They have wounded three Coast Guardsmen, one critically, and are holding two newsmen hostage. I think we'd have to say at this point, bomb or not, that this situation is a highly dangerous one. RBS News will stay with the story as it develops.
This is an RBS News special bulletin.
John, while we wait for this briefing from the Department of Energy, and let's stress once more that there is no indication so far that there is a bomb on board that ship. Presumably, the briefing will address itself to that question. Let's go back to Meg Barkley in Charleston, where a group of terrorists is holding two hostages. Meg, have there been any further developments?
Excuse me, Susan, there are so many walkie-talkies around here, it's difficult to hear.
Are there any further developments in the situation?
Susan, as you can see, the major change here is the number of people surrounding the dock and the snipers who have taken up positions in the roof of the warehouse next to us. There has been no activity on the ship, no sign of life whatever, but that has not deterred these hundreds of onlookers. It's curious, really, John. You mentioned the proud nature of the city. There's not been a lot of panic here. Some people did choose to leave, but most simply do not believe there is a threat.
Well, we have the Navy here. We have civil defense.
I wouldn't leave just because of a few false rumors. We've been here over 200 years.
Local historian Dr. Charles Eastman.
Well, Charlestonians, I believe, have a little fear of disaster. We've been through many disasters in our several centuries. There have been the Indian Wars. There was the invasion by the British. There was the late unpleasantness with the North. You recall Fort Sumter.
Walking into Charleston is like walking into the 19th century. It has perhaps the most aggressive
preservation. We're going to have to break away. Leon Patterson is at the Department of Energy with a briefing about to begin.
Susan, Walter S. Latow is the spokesman for the Department of Energy. Apparently, this briefing will center on the... I believe we're about to begin.
Ladies and gentlemen, please, I'm going to make a short statement. Regarding the situation in Charleston, South Carolina, the Department of Energy has investigated 85 incidents of this kind since 1974. In no case did the threat turn out to be real. We have no reason to believe that this situation is any different. I repeat, we have no evidence that the group on board that ship has any kind of nuclear device.
Why haven't you had any briefings on the other 85?
Because in the other incidents, you did not have a television network broadcasting the threat into every living room in America.
Well, what about the rumors of an evacuation, sir?
We have no plans at this time for evacuation. It is not possible to evacuate every city every time you have a threat like this. Ladies and gentlemen, please, there are no more questions. Thank you very much.
All right, that was Walter S. Latow, spokesman for the Department of Energy. We've had another demand for a live feed from the terrorists on board the ship in Charleston. Now, because of the danger to the two hostages on board, RBS is being responsive to these further demands for airtime. Stephen Levitt, are you there?
John, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but Dr. Lyman has a point he wants to make, and he wants to make
it
right now.
Thank you, Steve. I don't get the response here. Nobody seems to be taking this seriously. Walt Latow at the Energy Department and the FBI is still talking about negotiations. I'm known in the government. We're not crazies. There are about six advanced degrees among us. Dave McKeeson is known. Does everybody think this is a hoax? All right, listen to this. The bomb we have on board has 1/1,000,000th of the destructive power of the world's arsenals.
Wait,
excuse me. Russia and the United States can destroy 1,000,000 Charlestons. Where in God's name did they get all of that destructive power? Our aim is to stop it from being used. Persuasion has failed. Guilt has failed. Religion has failed. What else is there for us to do?
They have heard the facts.
I spent years designing those weapons for the Pentagon. I had my counterparts in the Soviet Union. Do you think we ever once considered the reality of the situation? Do you think the counterforce expresses the reality?
They are not interested in the planning department. They're not interested in this.
Then what?
Steve, come with me, please. Bring your camera and let me show you something.
You want to do that now?
Come on.
All right.
I'm working up a program on this, and pretty soon you can just run it on the computer, and it'll pretty well predict what people will do. So, but right now, let me just show you.
You have enough light? Is there? Can you
George,
see?
George, you gonna just a second. Okay,
all right,
go ahead.
Okay, this is it. Now, this is an implosion device. For those of you who are interested, this is what took out Nagasaki. It has fifth-generation mechanics. It's based on the classic Los Alamos design. It contains 5.2 kilos of plutonium. Now, I'm not going to get into the yield from 5.2 kilos. You have people who can do all that. Let me just say that the plutonium was stolen from Hanford, Washington, in June, and
Can you speak up just a bit?
Well, we started in March. We started in March and June and July and November of last year. Now, for those interested, I have taken the precaution of installing several anti-tamper devices of my own design. If anybody touches this thing, if anybody moves this thing, if the ship is moved, if the ship is towed out to sea, or if it is exploded, or if it is breathed on in any way that I don't like, this bomb will go off. Now, the only person who can disarm the anti-tamper devices is yours truly. Don't try bribing me and, offering me computers and stuff. I have all that kind of stuff. The only way to get me to disarm this thing is to bring me the detonating modules. Now, there are nest guys out there. This all can be verified. This is not a problem, and Mr. Woodley can just check it out. We're not amateurs.
Well, the agreement, such as it was, gave the terrorists a live feed in exchange for the release of the hostages. Now, frankly, I don't think that that sort of bargain includes this kind of gratuitous indulgence, if you will. I think I should reiterate, we do not know if their threat is real. And until that's determined, I think we should reserve the right to at least practice some restraint.
Liz Richardson is at the White House, where I believe the president has just arrived.
That's right, Susan. The president was at Camp David this morning when the crisis began. He was not scheduled to return until tomorrow. This is a shot taken a few minutes ago. We don't know if the Charleston situation had anything to do with this change in plans. The feeling here is that it did not. Acting Press Secretary Bob Grafton made it clear that, at least with the information now at hand, it's pretty much a local matter. Back to you.
Thank you, Liz. Ellen Stevens is at the FBI, and she's been able to compile some information about these terrorists on board the ship.
Voted most likely to succeed at the Dorset School's class of 58, Bruce Lyman surprised everyone by joining the Marines and became one of the first Americans to serve in Vietnam as an advisor in the early 60s. Later, he attended Dartmouth, received a PhD from Yale in political science. In 1969, Lyman became a consultant with the Severin Group, a controversial think tank in upstate New York with strong ties to the National Security Agency. Lyman then joined the Defense Department in 1975, becoming one of the top strategic nuclear weapons planners. In 1977, he testified before the Senate.
Dr. Lyman, you are saying the yield will be greater?
Senator, I'm saying the neutron weapon has a greater short-term yield. The distinction is important. Now,
Lyman was instrumental in the eventual decision to build the neutron bomb. Then in 1978, for reasons unknown, he left the Pentagon. Soon after, he began to affiliate himself with anti-nuclear causes.
In the history of mankind, and those of us who know what we have created have a sacred obligation to tell you, the people, so that you can tell our leaders, enough, the madness ends here.
Bruce just got fed up, I think. You deal with these issues for so long, and then all of a sudden you just lose it.
In 1980, Lyman with several others broke into the Sand Island nuclear power plant and poured human blood into the main reactor cooling vents. In the resulting melee, several policemen were injured. Convicted of incitement to riot and assaulting a police officer, in a controversial decision, Lyman was sentenced to 4 years at Attica State Penitentiary, a maximum security prison in upstate New York. He served 14 months before an appeals court overturned the conviction. His parents, who still live in Mamaroneck, New York, had no comments on today's strange developments. David McKeeson, 36 years old, a nuclear physicist, said to be brilliant, a top man in his field. He was fired from the Hanford, Washington nuclear weapons facility last year after taking part in public demonstrations against the MX missile.
I mean, you're building weapons that will kill 10 million people in 3 seconds. You have to be really sure you're doing the right thing, that that God's on your side. I don't think Dave was ever sure about that.
Freda Barton, poet and political activist. In 1968, she received the Whitewood Poetry Prize for her collection entitled In the Shadow of the Dream. A well-known radical during the campus unrest in the 1960s, in recent years she has moved into more extreme forms of expression, joining the Communist Labor Party. Several years ago, she was implicated in the Garthwaite bombing in New York City when a homemade bomb exploded in a basement townhouse and killed 4 people. She has been underground ever since. Diane Silverman. With no criminal record at all, she is the most unlikely member of the group. RBS has learned that she is a married social worker from Penn Valley, a suburb of Philadelphia. Her husband met with reporters earlier today.
She knew Bruce Lyman for a long time, since graduate school.
How many were they romantically involved?
Your wife and Bruce Lyman, were they politically involved?
What was the name of the organization?
Of course they were not. What do you mean romantically involved? They were students together.
James Seaver, the unknown variable. The FBI has been unable to locate any record or history of this last member of the group. Without further identifying characteristics, it may be some time before we know anything about him at all. What brought this group together? Is their threat real? And if it is, where did they get the funds to build it? The FBI has no answers, and no answers either for the biggest question of all. Why? Why would a respected planner and a brilliant scientist threaten to blow up an entire city? This is Ellen Stevens, RBS News.
RBS News has just learned that one of the Coast Guardsmen wounded this morning, Mark Harris, has died of his wounds. Harris was hit twice, once in the shoulder and once in the head, and never regained consciousness. Of the other two Coast Guard personnel, William Joseph Gregson is in stable condition, and Lyle Freeman has been released with minor injuries.
Susan, it's very hard to escape the feeling right now that the ante has been upped considerably by this tragedy. Even if the situation is brought under control, these people on board that ship now will stand trial for murder.
I wonder if this will have any impact on their intentions. Maybe Steve Levitt can shed some light on this. Are we getting through to the ship? Steve Levitt, can you hear me?
Yes, we are here. We saw that report on the monitor, as we have seen everything that has come over the monitor. You would have to say that the group is reacting very strongly to this news. Perhaps we can talk to Freda. Miss Barton, could you give us some sort of statement concerning the death of the Coast Guardsman?
Well, there's a lot I could say, but saying never achieves the doing. Well, let us not forget that one man is like all men, and all men dying is a succession of one man dying. And I grieve for this one. I grieve for his family. And I say indeed, and I mean it, I am sorry. I am deeply sorry. But I am concerned with all men. And does this distract me from my goal? No, not in the least. No.
Dr. Lyman.
Oh, no!
Dr. McKeeson. David? Susan, I would have to say that the group is affected.
They're just not talking.
Excuse me, Stephen, we're going to have to break away. Morton Saunders is at the Capitol with what I believe is something on the stolen plutonium. Morton?
John, the tangled halls of the Capitol hardly seem the place to uncover stolen radioactive material. But we'll take our leads where we find them. I'm holding in my hand a confidential memo written by a Senate aide. I can't say who. A memo which confirms that more than 5 kilograms of plutonium were found missing from the Hanford, Washington facility in January of this year.
Morton, if I understand you correctly, that's in keeping with Dr. McKeeson's claims of when and where he obtained the plutonium?
That's correct, Susan. This in the face of several government denials that any plutonium was missing.
Have you gotten any response at all to the memo you're holding?
We're expecting that shortly. The off-the-record response has been nothing short of a firestorm. Everyone's been operating under the assumption that this was a hoax. Now they're not so
Morton,
sure.
Morton, I'm being told that the White House is going to make an announcement in a very few minutes. Perhaps the mystery will be cleared up.
Let's hope so.
In the meantime, we're going to speak to two gentlemen who might be able to throw some light on this situation. One is Dr. Niels Johansson of the Institute for Energy Research at Princeton in New Jersey, and the other is Dr. Morse Mansfield of the Severin Group in upstate New York. Dr. Mansfield, what about this plutonium?
Ms. Miles, there's a myth about plutonium security, that the stuff's just lying there waiting for somebody to put it in his pocket. It's just not true. We have inefficiency. Good God, yes. I believe Hanford lost the stuff, but I'll be damned if I believe Bruce stole it.
Dr. Johansson.
Yes, and on the other hand, David McKeeson is one of the 5 or so more intelligent atomic scientists working today. This, I would say, cannot be a good sign, yes?
Gentlemen, we'll be going to the White House in just a few moments. This demand for the detonating modules...
I don't believe the bomb is real. We're witnessing an extraordinary kind of bluff, a poker move, simple as that. Dave McKeeson discovers 5.2 kilos are missing from Hanford and says he stole them. I'd hate to modalize a retreat on that basis.
Dr. Johansson, a few seconds.
Morse wishes to play card games with the life of an entire city. Are you asking me if I think the bomb is real? I think David McKeeson is capable of it. Yes.
Thank you, gentlemen. We're going to have to break away. Robert Grafton, the acting presidential press secretary, is about to make a statement from the White House.
The president has asked me to make an announcement. We're not going to take any questions. To our knowledge, I want to make this clear. To our knowledge, there is no evidence that the threat in Charleston has any substance whatsoever. It is a cruel and irresponsible affront to the citizens of that great city and to everyone who calls himself an American. Now, in the interest of public safety, to ensure order and calm, the president is ordering the limited evacuation of the Charleston area. He is taking this step. He is taking this step to assure the people of Charleston that everything possible is being done. The evacuation will be handled under federal health emergency guidelines. We'll have further briefings as the situation resolves itself. Thank you.
That was Acting Presidential Press Secretary Bob Grafton announcing a limited evacuation of the Charleston area.
Susan, it's impossible for them not to realize the effect this announcement will have.
Well, he took great pains to make it clear that there's no evidence that the bomb is real.
It's also significant what he didn't say. He didn't say there was no nuclear material on that ship. I presume that's something that can be determined. Nor did he mention the missing plutonium, whether to confirm it or deny it. I suppose if we need evidence that their threat has substance, we'd have to go aboard that ship and have a look for ourselves. Short of that, I think we have to ask ourselves, what does the government know that would suddenly make it change its course and order the unprecedented evacuation of an entire city? RBS News coverage of the events of this extraordinary day will continue. Well, it's now past midnight. If you've been with us throughout the evening, you'll remember the announcement heard earlier. Some of the most ominous words in American history. When nuclear terrorism leapt from the pages of literature into stark reality. Walter S. Lateau of the Department of Energy.
That the nuclear emergency search team has reason to believe there is fissionable material on board in the configuration of a bomb.
The pictures that came in soon after, the astounding live coverage as a city was plunged into chaos.
Evacuate your homes safely and as quickly as possible.
Ma'am, we're evacuating this part of the city. If you get your valuables and your possessions...
A nightmare come true. And amid the panic, there was violence. One man shot another motorist who had rear-ended him. Looting was widespread as the city emptied out. And many of those who tried to leave found themselves blocked at every turn. In a scene that reminded many of the refugees from Poland in 1939, thousands of people were forced to carry their belongings out of the city on foot, dragging wheelbarrows, hand carts. It continued throughout the night. Bernard Frost was there.
The Federal Disaster Control Agency had a plan for the evacuation of Charleston, but it proved to be totally inadequate.
There's no reason for panic at this time. Stop now. I've already made a...
The plan, copies of which have been obtained by RBS News, did not account for possible interruptions of the traffic flow, not even stalled cars or flat tires. Within a half hour, there were many of both. Outside the city, hospitals and high schools were quickly converted into evacuation centers. But shortages of space and supplies soon became critical. National Guard troops were brought in to keep order. The sense of shock is mounting. In the hundreds of evacuation centers around the area, there is a mood of helplessness and anger. Anger at authorities who seem unable to cope with the level of chaos, but most of all, anger at a small group on a ship in Charleston Harbor.
I think they're crazy, I really do. I mean, what kind of people would do that to a whole city?
Bernard Frost, RBS News, outside of Charleston.
As in Charleston, the mood of panic in Washington is matched by feelings of anger. When the announcement came at 3:30 today, the Senate adjourned in chaos. Burton Lamb of Louisiana was apparently so furious he didn't wait for his limousine to show up.
Why isn't anybody wondering? Why aren't they thinking about what the role is of the communists in Charleston?
Among the voices of rage, few counseled moderation. Earlier today, I spoke with Senator Ryan of Pennsylvania.
Well, Morton, certainly we can't compromise the security of the United States. But on the other hand, I can't countenance the destruction of an entire American city. I don't envy the president on this one.
Atlanta, Georgia, 290 miles from Charleston, presumably safe, even if the bomb were to explode. But you wouldn't know it from the citizens of Atlanta.
I heard there was one close by here, too.
By noon, the police department had logged 15 nuclear extortion threats.
They're all hoaxes, but the government wants to check them out anyway.
Atlanta's experience was repeated around the country. Washington, 8 extortion calls. St. Louis, 6. New York, 67.
Yeah, it really makes them come out of the woodwork, doesn't it?
In Philadelphia, as in other cities, churches and synagogues were filled to capacity as people try to find comfort. Observers say nothing has touched the American nerve like this since John Kennedy was assassinated. That feeling of helplessness and dread, the knowing that it could happen anywhere. It almost happened here at the Washington Monument not long ago, when a man claiming to have 1,000 pounds of explosives threatened to blow up the monument. The difference is Norman Mayer had no explosives. Bruce Lyman does, of a much more threatening kind. That difference may yet rock the very foundations of our country. Terrorism has reached the atomic age.
As this difficult, frightening day draws to a close, there is one subject we can't avoid discussing, and that is the horrible consequences for Charleston if, in the worst of all situations, the device on board the ship should explode. RBS science correspondent Arlen Seri reports.
Charleston, South Carolina, one of America's most beautiful cities, with an international arts festival, a strong preservation program, in many ways a secret city, untouched by time. While the city guarded its past, just up the river developed one of the nation's major nuclear weapons staging areas.
Any ironclads cruising past the Charleston docks today are likely to be Poseidon submarines.
This is the city that is threatened today. In many ways, a study in contrasts. RBS News, with the help of the MIT Physics Department, has prepared the following computer simulation of what might take place were the bomb to explode less than 17 hours from now. At ground zero, 0 hour, the fireball would begin. Its projected yield would be roughly equivalent to the bomb dropped on Hiroshima on August 6, 1945. Initial temperatures reach 10 million degrees. A heat pulse is traveling at the speed of light in all directions. Even a mile away, someone standing in direct line of the blast would be instantly burned to death.
I was coming around the corner. There was this beautiful light. And the burning came. My sister was ahead of me. I turned the corner. She wasn't there anymore.
At ground zero, a crater has formed 100 yards in diameter and 50 yards deep. A blast wave is moving out more slowly than the heat, taking 2 seconds to travel the first half mile, destroying everything in its path. Beyond the first half mile, for another mile and a half, any building short of reinforced concrete would be severely damaged by the blast or destroyed in the firestorms that usually accompany nuclear detonations. National landmarks like Fort Sumter would be almost completely destroyed. In this first 2 mile radius around ground zero, there would be very few survivors. And those who did survive would suffer extreme radiation poisoning.
One of my brothers died of leukemia in 1958, another in 64. I think we're paying the price every day.
Because this would be a ground blast, a phenomenon known as the nuclear footprint would form. A corridor 5 miles wide and 50 miles long, stretching out from ground zero, contaminated by radiation, uninhabitable for years. In short, an atomic explosion in South Carolina would be devastating beyond the imagination of most people. A catastrophe such as the United States has never seen.
Arlen.
Yes, John.
Is it possible to compare the weapons deployed today, the kind the Russians may have aimed at Charleston, with what the terrorists have on that ship?
John, tonight, people who are 5 miles from the harbor would survive the blast, at least. If a Soviet 1 megaton bomb was dropped in the harbor, those people 5 miles away would be vaporized in the first 3/5 of a second.
Thank you, Arlen.
The situation in Charleston has many facets. Merritt Cunningham has a report on one of them.
A gunfight in a harbor. A local correspondent happens to be on the scene. Within hours, the situation escalates into a major crisis. The National Guard is mobilized. A city is evacuated. And a small dock in Charleston, South Carolina, becomes the media capital of the United States. Anti-nuclear groups especially wanted to get their point across.
That we're appalled at this kind of tactic. We're outraged that efforts of millions of concerned citizens have now been tainted by this abominable act. We're working for a real disarmament, a verifiable bilateral disarmament. It's sane and it's possible.
And there were those who criticized the role of the media.
Why give them the feed? Why do it? To save lives? Who says it doesn't cost more lives this way? As things escalate, as people do more and more outlandish things to gain the public eye. I'd take it out of the network's hand if you ask me. I don't trust their priorities. Make it illegal, just make it illegal to hand over a feed.
But the feed was given. And this is the way the dock looks tonight. The spectators and demonstrators are still here. Some, it seems, prepared to camp for the night. But they're camped in front of the TV cameras, as if lured by the light and excitement, as if the coverage of the event were more important than the event itself. That's become a fact of life in stories like this. Television is a presence that no one can ignore, not the police, nor the terrorists. It has become witness to the story, yet part of the story. And it will probably remain that way as long as people watch the news. Merritt Cunningham, RBS News, Charleston.
You know, John, this live feed from the ship, it's a product of amazing technological advances, and we have to wonder, if it were not available, would the terrorists have been able to gain a national forum, as they have?
Well, Susan, I think that reporters always tend to be blamed for the bad news they bring.
Well, yes, but it's a question of complicity. We have to ask the question if the news media actually contribute to the very situation.
Excuse me, Susan, we're going live. We're being joined live by Stephen Levitt on board the ship in Charleston. Go ahead, Steve.
Yes, John, the entire group has been watching the broadcast, and Dr. David McKeeson would like to make some kind of...
I just wanted to say that I have been listening to what you've been saying about how the news media is taken advantage of by people, and that's not really a problem, is it? I mean, the news media is essentially show business, isn't it? I mean, you guys have agents just like actors do, isn't that right? No, does John Woodley have an agent?
The ongoing crisis here.
I don't. No, I'm not me. All right.
No, yes, well, here, wait.
I would like to make a statement. I just want to say how much I love RBS News. And I didn't believe any of those stories about how John Woodley got mad when Susan Miles became a co-anchor person. Those stories were circulating. That's not true, John. You didn't get mad, did you? And one more thing. I love this logo with America under siege. What are you... With music in the background, and it just gives me chills. It makes me real proud to be a part of this whole thing. I am... It never ceases to amaze me the ability of the news media to trivialize any event of any significance, any meaning. It just, I don't know, I just, it's, what?
What are you doing, Dave?
People are talking about us like we're doing some sort of bad thing and a terrible thing, and we are trying to do something we are making a statement. We're trying to do a good thing, just like John Woodley is trying to do a good thing, and I think that we're together on this. Right?
Well, I think any connection between what Dr. McKeeson is doing and RBS's attempts to cover it is highly remote.
John, you guys eat us for... You eat us for breakfast and for lunch. You have, like, an earthquake or a plane crash or something. John Woodley, good Anglo-Saxon name. I hope it's his own.
He's not the enemy, Dave.
John?
He's just a friend.
John, are you there?
Yes, Dr. McKeeson.
Well, does this qualify as gratuitous self-indulgence?
Well, perhaps that's in the mind of the beholder, Dr. McKeeson, if you choose to think of it like that.
I'm getting John mad here now. I don't mean to get John mad. See, I'm just trying to improve your rating points.
You think this is about ratings?
John, you tell me. Here's what you do. I want you to call up NBC, call up CBS, and get them on the line, and you tell them that there's a story here that you don't want to cover anymore. This will show me, then. There's a story you don't want to cover. Take Steve out of here, because Steve has really doing a great job, and I know that if he stayed here, his career would be made with RBS. But if it doesn't mean, rating points don't mean anything to you, then what I want you to do is cut me off. Just pull the plug. I mean, if you're so righteous, if it doesn't matter to you that the entire country is tuned to RBS for exclusive coverage, we'll just end it. I mean, NBC would kill its mother for this footage. Any of them would. So, but if it doesn't matter to you, fine, and cut it off. I would like to see RBS willingly give up exclusive coverage. This would be interesting. Let's see it. I'm waiting. Well, I guess we all know where we stand, don't we?
That was Dr. David McKeeson, one of a group of terrorists threatening to detonate a nuclear bomb 17 hours from now. He made several points about the exploitation of news events by the news media. And as an example, he used RBS coverage of this particular event. It was a strong attack, I think I can say very strongly worded. And just to make sure that the factual record is clear, RBS News long ago made Stephen Levitt's reports from that ship available to all the other networks. This exclusive coverage that Dr. McKeeson referred to simply does not exist. And I think that's all that need be said on that subject. This is John Woodley and Susan Miles in New York. RBS coverage of the crisis in Charleston will continue.
Good morning. This is Susan Miles and John Woodley in New York on this, the second morning of a crisis that has riveted the attention of the world. In Charleston, South Carolina, a group of terrorists are demanding that unless the area's nuclear weapons are disarmed, they will explode their own nuclear bomb.
The president is ordering the limited evacuation of the Charleston area.
And now, as the second day has begun, another frightening development in Charleston earlier this morning.
It began at 7:43 this morning, a news helicopter venturing too close to the ship. James Seaver, the silent terrorist, made himself heard at last with a vengeance.
It's going down! Now!
After a tense and sleepless night, Seaver seemed all at once to succumb to the pressure. Bruce Lyman, the leader of the group, was unable to calm Seaver down. Stephen Levitt attempted to help. A scuffle broke out. Seaver demanded a microphone, claiming he had a statement to make.
You too, because you work for them, man. You work for them. The ones up there, because I've seen what goes on your channels, and because it's all like the same thing, you know? I've seen you guys. You have some guy on there, and then you start laughing at him. The next thing you know, I've seen it, man.
He proceeded to issue a strange and seemingly irrational string of demands.
They want a Porsche, and they want $340,000.
After half an hour, Seaver abruptly stopped talking and sat down.
This doesn't mean anything. Jim is, he's a sensitive guy, and nothing has changed.
But as the morning wore on, it became clear things had changed. Diane Silverman, one of the terrorists, requested a telephone hookup with her husband.
David, I don't know if I'm... The kids are watching, aren't they?
Yes, they've been watching. They're seeing everything. They're watching.
They're watching now.
An FBI negotiator was called in, as it seemed Diane Silverman was about to give herself up. By 9 a.m., the government itself seemed uncertain, faced as it was by a group whose behavior was becoming increasingly unpredictable.
This morning's events in Charleston cast a pall on an already gloomy morning in Washington. Members of Congress are only too aware that the authorities in question have had nothing public to say since the crisis was recognized at 3 p.m. yesterday. John Morgan of Kentucky apparently knew some of the answers, but he wasn't letting
on. There's going to be a settlement. There's going to be an accommodation. Now, I think what the accommodation is, let's just stay calm and have faith in our president. All that there is right now. We'll be back with you when we have more. Thanks very much.
Two words, accommodation, settlement. As near as can be seen, they indicate the government's direction in the handling of the Charleston crisis. Those arguing against such a course have yet to come up with any other options. The president himself has apparently decided that an armed attack on the ship would be too risky. This is Morton Saunders, RBS News, the Capitol.
RBS News has learned that at 8:10 this morning, the president ordered the nation's nuclear forces on full alert. Apparently, the move was made as a signal to the Soviets that the United States defenses are still intact. Whether they will remain intact, or whether the rumors of accommodation with the terrorists are correct, no one can yet say. Jonathan E. Herman, RBS News, the Pentagon.
The terrorist who fired at the helicopter this morning, James Seaver, has finally been identified by the FBI. Ellen Stevens has that story.
James Seaver. Until he showed his face this morning and started speaking, the FBI had no leads in their efforts to identify him. Then at 9 o'clock this morning, the FBI received a phone call from local authorities in Elmira, New York. James Seaver was recognized as the man convicted in 1971 of wounding bank teller Martha Verona during a robbery that was photographed by security cameras. Under his real name, James Anthony Stromer, Seaver had been sentenced to 25 years at Attica State Penitentiary. Stromer was still at Attica in 1979 when Bruce Lyman served 14 months for incitement to riot and assault. Ex-cellmate Jimmy Lennox.
That guy is a walking psycho ward. That's about the best way I could put it. He's a nut.
Ellen Stevens, RBS News, the J. Edgar Hoover Building.
There are about 140,000 people now in evacuation centers and private homes outside of Charleston. Bernard Frost reports on the conditions there.
The problems for those who have left have been staggering. Not enough food, not enough clothes, not enough medicine. After 19 hours of evacuation, the situation in many centers is critical. Families are still separated.
I tried to get in touch with the school to find out what happened, but they can't tell me anything. They were put on buses and hauled away, but I don't know where.
How are we going to feed 150,000 people?
But the federal government has been bringing in supplies around the clock from all across the country.
This rock is Jesus.
And, yeah, indeed, amid all the suffering and panic, not all the emotions have been negative. The evacuation centers have been witness to sometimes amazing examples of humanity and self-sacrifice. People giving up food for others. People giving up clothing so that others will not be cold. Indeed, those who feared that this crisis would bring about a general breakdown of society have been proven resoundingly incorrect.
And gripped his soul, Leroy.
If there is a message to be found, something about the resilience of the human spirit, this must be it. Bernard Frost, RBS News, at the Cali Junior High School.
Some residents of Charleston have expressed a Excuse me, I'm being told that we're going back to the ship now, perhaps for a clarification as to whether Diane Silverman is giving herself up to the FBI. Steve Levin.
What?
Our agreement that says this maximum goal of demonstration. What am I doing? It's growing on my guts for 17 days.
Yes, Susan. Susan, I'm sorry. It's very hard to hear you right now.
Is what? Diane Silverman still speaking with the FBI?
No, she's not. She's staying.
I say we've been hearing some reports from Washington, hints that they may be moving toward a concession to Dr. Lyman's demand.
Dr. Lyman, we are hearing hints from the government now that they are about to give in to your demands.
Well, it's lovely the way the government drops hints. I want to hear something.
I don't want to feed him in here.
No, come on.
All right, okay, I'm doing it. I'll set it off right now, damn it. I'm going to do it.
We've just heard Dr. McKeeson apparently threatening to detonate the nuclear device. I don't think I'm exaggerating when I say that the situation on board that ship is deteriorating rapidly.
As the time of their deadline runs out, whatever intention they may have had, whatever message they may have wanted to get across, at this point, is totally lost. This is Susan Miles with John Woodley. RBS News coverage of the crisis in Charleston will continue. It's now 4:20, 10 minutes before the first deadline, and an hour and 40 minutes before the bomb is set to explode. There is no word from the ship or the government, although there are some changes around the dock, as Meg Barclay reports.
The images you are seeing are from unmanned cameras surrounding the Liberty May. Within the last half hour after the exchange of gunfire, all the demonstrators, spectators, media personnel, all mobile units were moved back a safe distance from the ship. The RBS control position is now on the aircraft carrier Yorktown, which has a permanent berth as a floating museum across the harbor from the tugboat.
Meg, what is the distance? How far are you from the Liberty May?
About 2 miles.
Is that considered a safe distance?
No one will say, actually. It's the furthest we could get and still cover the story.
As time runs out, the gentleman sitting next to me may be able to provide some insight into what's taking place on the Liberty May. Dr. Abraham Scherzma is a psychoanalyst in New York City. Doctor, the situation seems to have deteriorated rapidly aboard the ship. We've heard nothing at all for several hours.
Well, we have a very volatile mix there.
James Seaver's outburst.
God forbid I should be the one to disagree with the FBI. But in my opinion, James Seaver is not the most dangerous member of that group. That distinction belongs, I believe, to David McKeeson. He is a man, obviously. He's been hospitalized for paranoid-type disorder, but I think what's more important than that...
Excuse me, Doctor, could you explain that in a little more detail?
Well, a paranoid is somebody who takes threats that originate inside of his own mind, and he perceives them as coming from the outside world. So that an innocent comment, a chance coincidence of events can be interpreted as dire threats. But what I was trying to say, and I think this is more important, I understand that you have those two tapes
yes.
ready. This is why he is dangerous.
Maxwell Dover, ground up! Demonstration
what
is
have I, what have I done thing? Throwing my guts up for 17 days in a
That's
row?
It. I'm doing hold it there, please. What did I bust my guts for? Throwing up for 17 days in a row. Could we have the other one, please?
Phoebe, let's watch a nice movie. Set to some sort of nature
right.
setting.
You need something.
Whatever
yeah.
Well, what do you need?
No, I don't know.
What do you need?
This, I don't know. We'll stew. I need a white count. I need to find out.
Hold it again. Now, I wasn't exactly sure what this meant last night, but with the other exchange this morning, and I've talked to a number of physicists about this, I'm quite certain that David McKeeson contaminated himself with plutonium while he was making the bomb. It's an unbelievably toxic substance that causes radiation sickness at first. That's what he means by the vomiting. And it's the later stages, though, that are really deadly. Usually leukemia within a year to 18 months. That's what he means by the white count. David McKeeson is a very dangerous man because he knows that he's dying already. The bomb doesn't hold any danger for him anymore.
Excuse me, Dr. Scherzma. We've just made contact with the ship. We're going now to Steve Levitt live.
Yes, Susan, it looks like it's down to the wire.
Steve, it's quite a relief to reestablish contact. What was the problem?
Well, Dr. McKeeson had decided that there was no more...
Steve, we were worried that something had happened, on the ship. But it seems that things are actually calmer now than before.
Well, there's no more shouting, if that's what you mean. But considering that it is 4:25 and there has still been no response, I could hardly describe things here as calm.
Does anyone have anything they want to say?
Let me talk to Bruce. Dr. Lyman.
Yeah. Well, they're psychoanalyzing us. It's kind of neat. 5 minutes to go and they're psychoanalyzing us? I haven't lost control of anything. never had it. But this group knows exactly what it came here to do. And we haven't wavered. My God, why don't you analyze a government, the most powerful government on Earth, that sits and does nothing for 24 hours, and then ask yourselves who the real terrorists are? Excuse me.
Well, we're seeing exhaustion take its toll, John. Complicating a situation that's already, well, complicated enough.
Yes, indeed it is, and we have to wonder if I've just been handed this. I understand there's we're going to Morton Saunders at the Capitol right now. Morton?
I can now say with almost complete assurance that the government is going to accede to the terrorist demands. I've had this story confirmed by the Department of Energy, the Senate, the FBI, and the White House. Just moments ago, Senator Lackland of Wyoming had this to say.
The government never gives in. The government accommodates.
But what about the
I have no other statement.
This from a man who last month said that execution was too mild a form of punishment for terrorism. John, I think we're going to see events move very quickly now.
Morton, I'm being told that we have Jonathan Herman at the Pentagon. Perhaps he can substantiate it as well. Jonathan, are you there?
John, reports that... John...
I'm having difficulty hearing you, Jonathan.
25 minutes now.
Can you hear us?
John, reports that the government is giving in. I've been circulating the Pentagon for about 25 minutes now, and everyone I've talked to has denied it. For the Defense Department to accede to the terrorist demands would entail large crews working feverishly all around the Charleston area. I can tell you almost unequivocally that no such large-scale activity has been seen. Now, I know that Morton has confirmation from White House and DOE, but I must tell you there is none here.
Thank you, Jonathan Herman. We have two conflicting reports now, and it's anyone's guess at this point. Now, less than a minute before the deadline, an hour and a half before the bomb is actually set to go off.
John... It would seem likely that in spite of what Jonathan Herman says, that that the government will accede to the demands.
Well, Susan, on the other hand, it's been the long-standing reasoning of the Israelis never to negotiate with terrorists. And they've had a lot more experience with this sort of thing than we have. Time is running out.
12 seconds. 8 seconds. I don't see what could happen now. 3 seconds. 3 seconds. We have now passed the terrorist's first deadline.
Is it possible there'll be no response?
It's now 4:31 and some seconds. We don't know what may be delaying the government's decision. We have now passed the terrorists' first deadline, the one they felt would give them enough time to take the detonators out to sea and destroy them. As for the bomb
itself...
Excuse
me, Susan, we're going to the White House right now, where a briefing is about to begin.
Authorized the removal of 968 computerized detonating modules from the strategic nuclear warheads based in the Charleston, South Carolina area. These modules have been removed from their warheads and are now on their way to the tugboat Liberty May. There, they will be loaded onto the ship. When the loading is complete, the ship will be allowed to move out to sea. Neither the loading nor the exit from the harbor will be impeded. Signed, the President of the United States. Thank you.
We may at least... be seeing the end of the drama in Charleston. We'll go now to the ship for a reaction from the terrorists.
Dr. Lyman, it looks as though you have succeeded.
It's hard to tell. We may have won, I don't know. The signs are auspicious, but we're going to have to see those trucks coming here before we're
start singing any hosannas. Jim, take a look from the bridge.
Grafton is an inveterate liar. He is an incurable liar.
We won.
You never believed him before.
Frieda Bird, Frieda, yes?
We won. We won. It doesn't matter whether the detonators come or not. We put our case before the American people. We won.
John, have we got any confirmation of the trucks coming down now? Meg Barkley, can she see the trucks? Can we get some confirmation that the trucks are indeed coming
Steve,
down?
Steve, I can't see anything right now. I'm going to look at the monitors from the unmanned cameras. I should be able to see the trucks when they get to be about 100 yards, maybe even 200 yards from your position, but I can't see anything right now.
While we're waiting, let's go back to the Capitol and Morton Saunders. After all, he was the one who went with this story before anyone else. Well, Mort, first the plutonium, and now this, batting 1,000.
Thank you, John. I can now say, now that the announcement has been made, that the government reached
John, I think I see the trucks.
45 minutes.
Yes, I definitely see the trucks. I'm seeing a convoy of trucks. They're beginning to arrive right
Meg,
now.
We're going back inside the ship for a...
We did it! This is it, John. It really seems to be happening now. Let me see if I can get Dr. Lyman.
What do you think of that, Steve? Lyman, but what do you have to say to that,
you think
Steve?
That the American people are going to accept your tactics.
Steve, I never wanted to explode that bomb. Dave, we did it.
Doctor, do you think that the American people will accept your tactics?
The suffering in the world. The world is too dangerous, Steve. They'll accept it. I know they will. God, thank God. Excuse me. God bless the United States.
Dr. McKeeson, do you believe now that the trucks are really... John, as you can see...
Steve, the trucks are arriving at the dock right now. You
can
probably see them
see the trucks
if you
in the
look
street.
Out through the window. The trucks are parking now. They're unloading some
Meg,
boxes.
Can you see any official personnel? Is there any military presence there at all? Anything like
no,
that?
No, I can't see anybody right now. I'm looking in the monitor, and I can only see what you can see. But it does appear that they are proceeding as requested by the terrorists.
Oh, look at that. Look at that. It's a great day. Great, great day. Great.
The picture went out. Steve, what is going on here? What's going on?
I don't know.
Steve, what is going on?
I don't know what's going on.
Come on, come on.
Maybe somebody stepped on the wire.
Nobody stepped on the wire.
Nobody stepped on the
damn thing. What's going on here?
Steve, I don't know.
Hold on, nobody touched anything.
Somebody touched the wire.
What's going on? Just Steve, what's going on out there?
New York,
see this? What do you see out there? What's there?
John.
All right,
John.
I'm being
John, we have no picture here on the monitor, John.
They've had a power failure in a transmitter at WPIV. Steve, there's nothing intentional here. Every television...
Why don't you tell that to Dr. Lyman? Because he can't hear anything over the monitor now.
Dr. Lyman, we understand there's been a power failure in a transmitter in North Charleston.
What?
It has nothing to do whatsoever with what you're seeing on the dock.
What?
Every television in Charleston is off the air.
What?
They say there's been a power failure.
No, no, there's not a power. They're having a power failure right now.
They're still unloading out there.
Well, get ahead. Go up there and see what's going on the bridge. What's going on? Come on.
Oh, my God.
So I'm telling you.
Oh, my God, those are troops.
Give me that. Give me that. Oh,
George, I'm cut.
That's what you need, man, but I'll tell you what, you do it.
We got it, George. We got the bomb, man. We got it. We
don't think we've seen anything like this since the SLA shootout in 74, the Patty Hearst. My God, it's a miracle those two weren't killed. Is Lovett hurt? Did you hear?
He seems to have a cut.
Came out of it with a cut. Well, what we've seen here is that the government clearly had this plan in the works for some time. Put one over on all of us. The announcement, the trucks bringing the detonators, I believe the word is diversion, and it just went off like clockwork. And the amazing thing is that the bomb didn't explode. Well, I suppose that could still happen. We have a 6 o'clock deadline before we get carried away. Meg, Barkley, are you still there?
John, we were not able to see too much. Everyone here is just astounded, absolutely in the state of shock. We have been moved to a safer area of the Yorktown, the fantail, but we're just so happy that Steve Levitt is safe. What a brave moment, and that the bomb did not go off.
You can second that over here, Meg. Bernard Frost in the Cali Junior High Gym in Sweetbriar. We have some pretty excited people, as you can see. Back to you, Meg.
They seem to be getting everyone off the ship very quickly now. And there's Steve Levitt. He appears to be all right. And his cameraman, George Takashima, who took those incredible pictures.
We're seeing the picture from George Takashima's camera. Steve, can you hear me?
Yeah, John?
Steve,
yes,
you're
John?
All right.
Well, John, we're all a bit dazed right now. I have a little cut. It's nothing serious. John, I never thought I'd walk off that ship. They're bringing them out now. That's Jim Seaver.
Steve, excuse me, I believe that's Bruce Lyman.
That's Diane Silverman, I believe. There's Jim Seaver there. He's coming out now.
Steve. Did Lyman say anything during that final firefight? Did he have anything at all to say to you?
Well, no. To tell you the truth, John, we were all so worried about being killed at that moment that I wasn't able to hear anything that Dr. Lyman may have said. If he did say anything, I...
That cheering that you hear is for the Delta Commando team, I believe, and not... for Freda Barton.
Freda Barton is now being taken away by the Charleston police. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you. Thank you. Have one on me, all
well,
right?
Steve Levitt and George Takashima are safely off the ship. The authorities have taken over. All that remains now is for the NES team to begin disarming the bomb. Steve.
John, the NES team is now approaching the ship. They're going inside the ship now.
What we're seeing now are members of the Nuclear Emergency Search Team. This is a highly classified group. They've been organized, I think, 10 years or so. They're in a constant state of preparedness to deal with anything concerning nuclear contamination. Considering it's now just before 5, and the bomb, as far as we know, is set to go off at 6, they certainly have their work cut out for them.
We try to avoid words like courage and human spirit. I think as we watch these men board the ship, knowing the responsibility lies solely on their shoulders, those are the only words that come to mind. RBS coverage of the crisis in Charleston will continue.
From the beginning of the crisis, our intelligence showed
unmistakable signs of Soviet strategic alert. It was impossible to consider even for one moment, the weakening of defenses on the southeastern seaboard of the United States, not when we had a feasible plan for securing the ship.
It is now 20 minutes before 6. As you know, we've been standing by for the past 45 minutes, watching members of the nuclear emergency search team go on board, stabilize the environment on board the ship, determine that the anti-tamper devices were in effect, and they've decided to disarm the bomb where it sits.
I said before, and I will repeat, the attack on the terrorists was predicated on the total confidence that the nuclear emergency search team would be successful in disarming the anti-tamper devices on the bomb. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much.
The image you see behind me is from the Nest camera that they've brought on board the ship. Dr. Niels Johansen, the physicist from Princeton, has been kind enough to rejoin us to try and clarify some of what we're seeing. Dr. Johansen, a few moments ago on the dock, Stephen Levitt told us that the technicians had actually left the ship. Now it seems that that's not true.
Mr. Woodley, disarming a bomb is the easiest thing in the world. It's equivalent to pulling a plug. The problem here is getting to the plug. Dr. McKeeson has set up so many fail-safe devices, so many anti-tamper devices, double-blind devices, that the experts have spent the last 35 minutes just trying to get through them. A mistake in any one of them could set off the bomb.
Give me the double. That's it. Okay. All right. We're going to separate.
Okay.
Coming over. All right. We're going to separate.
He's disconnecting the status circuits that keep maintain the constant.
That one
I've got up to about a 4.3 here.
Whoa, what's this voltage?
Can you feed it?
It was already separated. He clipped it.
Is that one?
Whoa, 4.6. It's frying now.
All right, 8-4 procedure, implement, go. All right, down. Here we go, hold it. I'll read it.
Okay, hold on. All right, now.
John, something seems to be going wrong here. Have you heard anything there in New York?
Dr. Johansen.
There's a double reverse situation and not what they expected. The danger is that having connected the sat, it will set up a feedback that will...
Dr. Johansen, please, in layman's terms.
It's getting hotter.
There is about 100 pounds of explosives in there.
I'm coming.
Geared to set off the chain reaction. They have just put a match under the whole pile.
Steve, you and George should move back.
No, John, I'm going to stay right here. We still have 17 minutes left. I'm not going to leave the dock until these people leave. They are still...
We still have about 17 minutes left, right?
John, there are two more trucks now arriving at the dock.
5.5 here. Command control, copy. Do you copy? We're up to 5.6. What's the reading?
All right.
I'm up to 5.6.
5.6. All right, now we're
going
to have time.
Something seems to be going wrong. I don't know what it is, though.
Come on.
Steve, you and George, get out of there.
Come on.
I'm sorry, John. I couldn't hear your last question.
Come on.
No, things seem pretty calm here right now. There's not a...
Somebody give me some information, damn it!
The hell is this?
Apparently, we have lost contact with Steve Levitt in Charleston. It is possible that there's been some kind of detonation. We're awaiting further details.
Okay. Meg? Barclay, we have Meg Barclay in Charleston.
Can you, Stuart?
Meg?
Can somebody help?
Meg, it's Susan Miles in New York.
Can you hear me?
You there?
Yes, Meg. Susan. Susan Miles in New York. Can you hear me, Meg?
It's... Oh, my God, it's...
Meg, please tell us what happened.
We saw it. Didn't you see it? Look. Look.
Meg? Meg? Come back.
Look. Just look at it. It's on fire. Everything's on fire.
Oh, my God.
They told us. They did tell us if it happens. You know, nobody took it. I mean, I didn't take it seriously. If it happens, don't look at it. Somebody said that once, so I threw myself down, and Bobby didn't, and he's dead. Stuart's okay. He has the camera. He's okay. I'm all right. I have this, Is the radiation coming now? Does anybody know that? I mean, are we hurt? Are we gonna die? Oh. There's some glass here. There's some glass here on Bobby's back. Stuart says he has a tape of the explosion.
Tell him to run the tape, Meg. Run the tape.
Master chess guys, what are they? Nobody tells us anything around. Hey, Stuart, can you see what's up? Stuart, you think the radiation is gonna come now?
John, John.
Is there something we can do? Is there anything we can do? There's got to be something we can do. Now, someone figure out what we're supposed to do. This is RBS News. There has been an atomic explosion in Charleston, South Carolina. Can we get somebody? Anybody? Herman at the Pentagon.
We have Merrick Cunningham now in Charleston.
Firestorm of enormous force and destruction. The people are... Oh, my God, this is terrible. I can't... I can't describe what's going on. Some of these people, the burns. It's just utter fear and confusion. Panic is. I can't go on.
The city's on fire. John, this is. People are standing and watching the city burn. The injured are beginning to arrive.
Excuse me.
God. This is incredible, John. In all my years of fighting, I've never seen anything like this. It's incredible. People are burned beyond recognition. They're trying to help out. I don't know what...
We're going to the White House now. The White House briefing room, Robert Grafton.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have just received word from Charleston, South Carolina, that a nuclear detonation of undetermined magnitude has just taken place a few moments ago. We don't know anything else except the damage and injuries are expected to be extensive. The Army is already airlifting support to the area. I'm not going to say any more at this time until we have a better idea of what exactly has taken place. There's just one last thing. Those who survived are going to need our prayers just as much as those who didn't.
This is a very dark moment.
Good evening. This is Newswatch. Emergency efforts continue in Charleston, South Carolina, where 3 days ago an atomic explosion destroyed the heart of the city. Estimated at a yield of 23,000 tons of TNT, the blast was seen and heard up to 400 miles away and created a firestorm that is still burning in several areas. Due to earlier evacuation, the number of dead is estimated at less than 2,000. But at last count, there were more than 25,000 injured. Many of those are burned and have been flown to hospitals around the country for treatment. But altogether, the burn care centers in the United States have only 2,400 beds, less than half the number needed for the victims of the Charleston blast. Because of onshore winds spreading fallout west of the city, 250,000 more people have been evacuated from outlying areas. In all, 500,000 are homeless. Scientists estimate that it may be years before the region is safe to reoccupy. Trauma care centers are being set up to care for survivors, many of whom are physically uninjured, but suffering from shock and delayed stress. Authorities are also caring for hundreds of children who are either orphaned or cannot find their parents. Counselors tell of recurring nightmares and shock. One child of nine, apparently, committed suicide. After 3 days, the shock seems to be just setting in. Early talk of rebuilding has been forgotten in the wake of radiation estimates. Hundreds of thousands of refugees face the prospect of starting new lives elsewhere in an already depressed economy. As for Charleston itself, the city of gardens and narrow streets and beautiful old houses, that city is gone forever. A new city may someday grow there, years from now, or it may remain a desert. Whichever, the staggering loss of what once was can never be eradicated. In other news, more riots in Poland today as demonstrators clashed with police over working conditions at the Gdansk shipyards. Reports indicate at least 27 injured. The World Bank met in emergency session today, stirring fears of international panic in the wake of yesterday's surprise default by Peru on a $27 billion loan. I'm Susan Miles. More news later on most of these RBS stations. Good night.